Yes. So welcome back to Excelsior Academy and in the fourth lecture of biomolecules, amino acids. So in the previous class, we talked about how the proteins needs to be separated and purified. So in this topic, we are going to study each step in detail. So the first, we talked about the cell lysis. In the previous lecture, I have already mentioned that the cell lysis is important step because you need to purify proteins. So let it be, it is your membrane protein or the cytoplasmic protein. Okay, so all these proteins need to be purified. So depending on your research topic, you need either membrane or the cytoplasmic. In both the cases, you need to lyse a cell. Now, what kind of cell material you can use? It can be either bacteria or animal cells or the plant cells. Okay, now as we know that animal cell destruction will be very easy because it does not have cell wall. Whereas both your bacteria as well as plant have the cell wall. Okay, so now in this session, we are going to talk about the different methods of cell lysis and in detail how exactly it to be carried out in the lab. So let's talk about cell lysis. So cell destruction, it is the process of obtaining intracellular fluid via methods that open the cell wall. Okay. Now, the overall goal is to obtain the intracellular fluid without disrupting any of its components. So I don't want to disrupt the cell in such a way that my interested protein gets precipitated or broken down or degraded. Okay. So I need it to be open up in such a way that all the components of the cells remain intact so that I can work further for my research. Now, the method used may vary depending on the type of the cell and its cell wall. Correct. See, if you want to have a protein, you cannot use the same method which you have used for animal cells. Because in the case of bacteria and plant, it has got the cell wall. So none of your protein will come out. So then it is of no use, right? Irrespective of the method used, the main aim is that the disruption must be effective and the method should not be too harsh so that the product recovered remains in its active form. Okay. So I want my protein to be in intact form so that I can work further. Now, these are the different methods of cell lysis method. Okay, so we see that there are two types, mechanical and non-mechanical. In case of mechanical, it includes high pressure homogenizer, bead mill. And whereas in the case of non-mechanical, we have got physical, chemical and biological. Now, under physical, we have got heating, osmotic shock and cavitation. Chemical means usage of detergents or alkaline method. In the case of biological, we use enzymes. This also, as I mentioned, if suppose you want to break down the cell wall of bacteria, what kind of enzymes are you going to use? So it will be your lysozyme, right? It is going to be your lysozyme. Now, if I talk about plant cell wall, then we know that the plant cell wall is made up of cellulose. So to break down cellulose, I need cellulase, correct? And in the case of animal cells, there is no cell wall. So no enzymes are required in order to break. But in order to remove the animal cells from its plate, because they are adhered, right, onto the surface of the flask in which it is grown. So you need trypsin so that it loses the contact with the surface and gets detached. So in all the three cases, whether the cell wall is present or not, you need the help of enzymes. Okay, so now let's talk more about the mechanical methods. So the mechanical methods are those methods which require some sort of force to separate out the intracellular protein without adding any chemical or enzyme. So examples are given: motor pestle, blender, bead beating, ultrasonification and homogenization. Now, motor pestle, this is very common in every lab. It is present, whether it is from your 11th standard to your research lab. In each lab, it is present. Okay. So it is just that it gives the cells a good grinding. So what you have to do first thing is that you take your sample and freeze into liquid nitrogen. Remember, what is the temperature of liquid nitrogen? It is around, liquid nitrogen temperature is around minus 196 degrees Celsius. So it's very, very, very low, right? At this temperature, your plant cells, your animal cells, whatever or the bacteria cells also. So they become freeze in the powdered form. Now once you start grinding it, right, you keep your sample. First you need to measure the weight of the sample, because that's how you're going to prepare your protein table also. So let us say that you started with your 100 gram of your sample. Then you add liquid nitrogen. You grind it. And then you add certain buffer. Go for total protein estimation. Okay. And then you start your purification. So at the end, you will know that from 100 gram of sample, how much was your protein of interest purified. Okay. So this is how you can start your protein purification steps. Now, when the material has been disrupted, metabolites can be extracted by adding the solvents also. So depending on your choice of interest, like whether it's protein or metabolites or carbohydrates or DNA, depending on that, you can start your purification or the separation techniques. Now, blenders, the use of blender. So this is like your home mixer where you add your certain samples and then you start blending it, right? So this is the same process used by centrifugation, which separates or concentrates material suspended in the liquid medium. So you have the sample, okay? What you do is you homogenize. So in this case, either you can have the machine, or what you can have is the small homogenizer, where in which you have the tube, you put that the homogenizer and you make it like this, okay? Just take it out, take it in, take it out. So because of the vacuum, the sample disrupts, the cell disrupts, okay? And then you centrifuge. So whatever comes in the solution part, that is your supernatant, you extract, and the pellet is nothing but your cell debris, so that you can throw it off. Bead beating. So these beads are there. So what happens is that into your sample, the beads are present. Okay, you are going to add the beads. So these beads can be made up of glass or ceramic. Okay, so because of this shearing, what happens between the beads, the cells, if the cells comes, what happens? They get it crushed and the cell wall gets disrupted. So because of these, the glass beads are used. But this kind of mechanical shear is gentle enough to keep organelles intact. So only the cell gets disrupted, but not your organelles. So it can be used with all kinds of cells. Just add beads to an equal amount of cell suspension and vortex. So what is vortex? You're just going to blend it. So with the hand, you cannot increase the rotation, right? So keep it on the machine and then vortex. Ultrasonication. Ultrasonic homogenizers work by inducing vibration in a titanium probe that is immersed in the cell solution. So this is again, the machine is somewhat like this. So you have got the probe, the ultrasound probe is there. You have your beaker. Inside the beaker, again, small tubes are there in which you add your sample. Okay. Now you insert the probe and start the machine. So what happens? Because of these ultrasonic waves, the cell starts getting disrupted. Okay. So the problem with ultrasonication is that there is an increase in the heat. So much of ultrasonic waves are going. So there is an increase in the heat. Now this heat might disrupt or denature your protein. So it might denature your protein. Now to prevent this, what you can do is you can keep your sample on ice. Okay. So this is how you protect your proteins from getting denatured. Now a process called cavitation occurs in which tiny bubbles are formed and explode, producing a local shockwave and disrupting the cell walls by pressure change. So this is ultrasonic homogenizer. This is called cavitation. So what happens in this, when it is applied, small bubbles are formed. Okay. Now when they get ruptured, it also helps in the disruption of the cell walls under the pressure. Now this method is very popular for plant and fungal cells. So we know the plant cell have got the cell wall of cellulose, and fungal have got for the chitin. And chitin is made up of N-acetyl glucosamine units. Okay, so fungal cell wall is made up of chitin. Chitin is made up of N-acetyl glucosamine units. So the only disadvantage is that it has got the noise, but that's okay, right? Yes. So this is how the machine looks. So this is what I was talking about. You have got the cell suspension. Okay. And this is the ultrasound tip. The probe is there and the generator. So you start the machine. What happens? Because of the sonic waves, your cell starts getting disrupted. Now you can keep the sample onto the eye so that because of the increased heat generation, your protein doesn't get denatured. Now coming to the homogenization, it is the liquid-based homogenization. It is the most widely used cell disruption technique for small volumes in culture cells. So this is I was talking about. So you have got a tube-like structure and then you can put like this. So it is like this. So because of the vacuum, you keep on doing like this. So what happens? Because of the vacuum, the pressure, because of the vacuum pressure, the cell walls disrupt. Okay. So cells are lysed by forcing the cellular tissue suspension through a narrow space. So even though I was showing like this, it's actually very narrow. Homogenizers use shearing force on the cell similar to the bead method. So it can be performed by squeezing the cells through a tiny tube and that is slightly smaller than the beads beating. Now let's talk about the non-mechanical method. So till now we were talking about the mechanical methods, right? So now let's talk about the non-mechanical method. So we again have got three categories, physical, chemical and biological. So let's discuss the first category, that is your physical methods. So we have got freeze thaw, microwave thermolysis, that is when you give the sample the microwave radiation, osmotic shock and the electric discharges. So what is freeze thaw? Freeze thaw means that you keep your sample at very low temperature, like if you freeze it in the minus 186 or minus 80 degrees Celsius, and then you thaw it. Thaw means bringing back to normal temperature. Again, you keep into the lower temperature once it gets freezed, then bring back to the normal temperature. Now, because of this freezing and bringing back to the normal temperature, what happens? The cell membrane, the cell wall becomes loose and it gets disrupted. Okay. So this method is used when working with soft plant material or algae. It is used to achieve cell disruption by a series of freezing and thawing cycles. So freezing forms the ice crystals which expand upon thawing and this ultimately causes the cell wall to rupture. Now microwave, so this is, it's similar to having the higher temperature methods. It is used to disrupt the bonds within the cell walls. But the problem with this method is that it is going to denature the protein. So I cannot work with microwave if I'm interested to work on proteins. So the case of DNA and RNA or the metabolites, I can use this method where the temperature is not going to affect that much. But in the case of proteins, no, because it will get denatured. Now, osmotic shock, for the spelling, it is S-O-S-M-O-T. So this is also simple. So remember when we talked about the osmosis, we talked about the hypotonic and hypertonic solution, right? So in the same way, if I have to rupture the cell, what I can do is, either I can have the hypotonic solution. So when I keep that cell into the hypotonic solution, what will happen? It will start, the osmosis will start. Okay. So I have the cells of this size. Now if I keep into the hypotonic solution, so this is my hypotonic solution. And this is my cell. Okay. Now what will happen because of the osmosis? What will happen? The cell will swell. And eventually it will burst. Okay. Now then I can take this solution having the cell components and I can carry out my protein separation techniques. Okay. Now, they only work in the case of animal cells, protozoa, because they do not have cell walls. So this we know as we have seen in the case of RBCs when we were studying about the osmosis. So if any doubts are there, please go back to the previous lectures and watch it again. Now, electrical discharges. It is possible to achieve cell disruption by electrical discharges in mammalian cells. So this they are talking about giving these small shocks. They are bounded by plasma membranes and have no cell wall, right? So this method allows researchers to examine secretion by exocytosis, which is a process during which membrane-bound sphere shifts and fuses with the plasma membrane. So remember when we were talking about the patch clamp technique, so they give the small vacuum pressure is given. So either that way also or in order to fuse, there is one video also on different types of cell fusion. So there we have talked about the electrical fusion. So what they do, they bring it about here nearby. Two cells are brought to nearby. They give the electrical discharge. So what happens? The membrane becomes loose and they try to merge. Okay, and then the fusion takes place. Now, if I keep on giving this electrical discharges continuously, what happens? The membrane loses its potential and finally it gets disrupted. Okay. Yes. Now, the chemical methods. This is also easy methods. So, if you're working mainly for the metabolites, you can just add chemical solvents like toluene, ether, benzene, ethanol, surfactants, ethyl alcohol, DMSO, etc. because it is easy for them to permeate the cell wall. Now, the only problem with this method is that you cannot work for proteins. Okay, so if you want to study about the secondary metabolites of plants and bacteria, then this type of chemical method is useful in order to study or disrupt the cells. Now, EDD can be used specifically to disrupt the cell walls of gram-negative bacteria, which contains the lipopolysaccharides, because the LPS is stabilized by magnesium and calcium. So when EDD, it is a ion chelator, right? Or chelator, like how the others are also pronouncing. So what they do, they take all these cations. So because of that, what will happen? The LPS is no longer able to stabilize the cell wall structure, and hence it loses and becomes permeable to all these methods. Okay, now this is the last topic, the enzymatic methods, and the interesting one also. So enzymes such as beta-1,6 and beta-1,3 glycanases, proteases, mannase can use to disrupt the cell wall, right? So here, as I mentioned before also, in the case of plant, they're also rich in cellulose. So either you can have, you can have cellulases or hemicellulases to disrupt the plant cell wall. Okay, please remember. Now, whereas in the case of bacteria, whenever we work with bacteria, we always add lysozyme. Now, why lysozyme? Because it can break the peptidoglycan layer. So these are the safe method, and it does not denature the protein. Okay. Now this method is particularly useful for isolating the cell without the cell wall. So that is called protoplast. So this was all about the cell lysis. So whether you have got fungus, plant, animal or bacteria as your source of cell, source of protein material, what you can do is, depending on their properties of the cell membrane and cell wall, you can use your first cell. Now, after that, the cell lysis, the another topic is about the crude cell extraction, then the fractionation, then dialysis and the chromatographic techniques. So chromatographic techniques is very important topic in biochemistry. Whenever a person is dealing with the protein purification, it is very important, and we'll be covering each chromatographic technique in detail, with its advantages and disadvantages. So hope you like this video, and thank you for listening. If any doubts are there, you can please comment to us, okay, or write to us at xshareacademy1228@gmail.com. Thank you for watching, and I hope you understood everything.